listening to Brahms' second piano concerto, the first and overwhelming impression is that it is a beautifully rounded and perfected composition. It seems to be the product almost of God-given inspiration. Yet, of course, on reflection, one realizes that this remarkable composition can only be the result of long thought and a most intensive care and construction. Every note, every passage, had a definite aesthetic purpose in the composer's mind. Actually, it took Brahms fully 3 years to complete it to his satisfaction. Deliberation, rather than inspiration, is the word that best describes his creative process. Yet there is one aspect of perfect composition such as this that is not deliberate. Indeed, the composer is only slightly conscious of it, and frequently not at all. That is the many musical influences that are revealed and that can be identified in the completed composition. These musical influences, stemming from his childhood and young manhood, are particularly interesting in the case of Brahms, and it will be highly enlightening not only about this piano concerto, but about all of Brahms' works, to be able to recognize them and identify them. Let us start from the beginning, when Brahms was a boy. His father was a musician of natural talents who played contrabass in a cafe orchestra in Hamburg. Waltzes, marches, polkas, and other popular music of that period were continuously being rehearsed in his home, with little Brahms, all ears, listening. This was dinner music at its best, serving in the cafe as background for conversation, just as in many German cafes today. A typical example is Die Schönbrunne, a waltz by the popular composer Joseph Lanner, the Richard Rogers of his day. This is how that waltz must have sounded to the young Johannes, as it was rehearsed by Brahms Sr. and his companions. The flute, the horns, the violin, and now the full orchestra joins in the waltz. Johannes always remembered and sang the melodies he heard, and this was the type of music he first heard. When he was 7, Johannes chose the piano as his instrument. His first piano teacher, Kassel, trained him to be a virtuoso. When he was only 10, he gave his first public concert. His program, typical of most recital programs of the day, included virtuoso pieces, like this etude by Henri Hertz. On the same program, on a higher musical plane, he also played the piano part of Beethoven's Wind Quintet, Opus 16, with his father and friends. This first brilliant performance charmed his audience, and a local manager promptly tried to sign up the young Brahms for an American tour. Brahms' family and friends were excited by the idea, but his teacher, wanting the boy to mature, opposed this plan. And immediately took him to the foremost musical authority in Hamburg, the pianist and composer, Edward Markson. Markson's musical influence on the boy musician was profound, so much so that 38 years later, Brahms affectionately dedicated this second piano concerto to my dear friend and teacher, Edward Markson. Markson immediately detected the inborn genius of the young 10-year-old pianist. Besides continuing his rigorous piano studies, Marxen soon introduced the young Brahms to Bach's music. And, very unusual for the time, a Bach fugue was included on Brahms' next public program. It might well have been this one in C major from the well-tempered clavier. It may not be entirely accidental that the opening notes of that subject resemble the opening notes of the concerto. Very soon after the beginning of his studies with Marxen, Brahms started composing works of his own, and it was almost inevitable that they should be rooted in his knowledge of the piano, so carefully nurtured by his teacher. But also, they clearly reveal his experiences in arranging marches, dances, and operas for his father's orchestra. Some of these early influences carry over almost 40 years later to this concerto. In the last movement, for example, there is this typical oompa-oompa section. Now, with the solo piano added, that section sounds like this. Also, in the second movement, you will hear this dance-like phrase. Besides dances and popular songs, Brahms undoubtedly heard many folk songs sung in the cafes where he played the piano. In fact, he once stated that his music grew almost entirely out of German folk songs. This was one of his favorites, Verstohlen geht der Mond auf. Verstohlen geht der Mond auf. Blau, blau, Blümelein, durch Silberwolken fällt sein auf. Rosen im Tal, Mädel im Saal. Oh, schönste. These folk song settings had a profound effect on Brahms' art songs. For example, this haunting melody from Immer leiser wird mein Schlummer is typical of this particular influence. That melody is almost exactly like the main theme of the slow movement of the concerto. This is the way it sounds in the concerto, with a solo cello substituted for the solo voice.